Yashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jai Gopijana Vallabha Girivaradhari. Yashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Radha Madhava Radhe. Jaya Radha Gopinath Radha Gopinath Radhe. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada Prabhupada Prabhupada. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada. Nitya Gaura Haribol Haribol Haribol. Nitya Gaura Haribol.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 21. Entitled Explanation of the Vedic Path. This is text number 20.
Kaler Durvishaha Krodas Tasmastam Anuvartate Tamasagrasyate Pumshas Chetana Vyapini Drutam Kaler Durvishaha Krodas Tamastam Anuvartate
tamasagrasyate pumshas chetana vyapini drutam kaler durvisah krodas tamastam anuvartate tamasagrasyate pumshas chetana vyapini drutam tamasatamanuvartate tamasagrasyate pumshas chetana vyapini drutam. Matajis kale from coral, durvishaha intolerable, krodaha anger, tamaha ignorance, tam that anger, anuvartate follows, tamasa by ignorance, grasyate is seized, pumsaha of a man, chetana the consciousness, vyapini broad, drutam swiftly. Translation: from quarrel arises intolerable anger, followed by the darkness of ignorance. This ignorance quickly overtakes a man's broad intelligence. Purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. The desire for material association arises from one's propensity to deny that everything is God's energy, falsely imagining material sense objects to be separate from the Supreme Lord. One desires to enjoy them. Such desire gives rise to conflict and quarrel in human society. This conflict inevitably gives rise to great anger, which makes human beings become foolish and destructive. Thus, the actual goal of human life is quickly forgotten. Om Agyanti Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutaha Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Ragunatam Tam Tum Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Revam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Upesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhano Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataro Bhyascha Kripasando Bhyavacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. Just read the translation once again. From quarrel arises intolerable anger, followed by the darkness of ignorance. This ignorance quickly overtakes a man's broad intelligence. Hare Krishna.
Hare.
Very grateful and happy to be here giving some thoughts on this very interesting translation and purport. So this is Krishna speaking to Uddhava, and he's giving many insights into the Vedic path. So as he is talking so many other aspects of the Vedic path, he is also highlighting a very important element in human psychology, in the understanding of how Kali Yuga functions. So here in the purport, Prabhupada is, the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, they are giving a very interesting angle to quarrel. So the purport says, this conflict inevitably gives rise to great anger, which makes human beings become foolish and destructive. Thus the actual goal of human life is quickly forgotten. So here the focus is about how conflicts arise and what conflicts do to human society. Now, to really understand this this aspect very nicely, I would like to take a story from two sources, the Devi Bhagavat and the Mahabharat together. And this story really brings a deeper insight into how conflicts arise and how do you deal with conflicts? And also talks about the mindset behind the conflicts. So this story is a story of the gods and the demons, the demigods and the demons, who constantly have fights, constantly have clashes. And this is a story about how these clashes go so deep that each one is ready to do anything to the other person, basically. And then in the end, we will come to a very interesting conclusion about how to see the two conflicts, you know, the good versus evil, the good and the bad, in a very different light. So the story begins with Shukracharya, who is the guru of the daityas, the demons. And Shukracharya, one particular time, he changes sides. He changes sides from the side of the demons. He goes and stays with the devatas. I mean, just imagine, if the guru only changes sides, you know, what happens to the disciples? So the disciples are all bewildered, the demons are all bewildered. How did their guru go from their side? So the demons, at one point, they come to a situation where they find Shukracharya alone. They catch him and pull him aside. And they ask him, why did you do this to us? Why did you just leave us and go? We had so much on you, hope on you. In fact, Shukracharya had made the demons so dependent on him that practically the demons could do nothing without Shukracharya's sanction or without Shukracharya's help. See, the role of a spiritual master is to empower and leave. A lot of spiritual masters, sometimes what they end up doing is they make the disciples so dependent on them that the disciple can't do anything without their help, practically. So Shukracharya, he was there for the demons. So every problem that the demons had, Shukracharya would find solutions for them. And as a result, the demons actually didn't grow in their own propensity to find solutions to the problems of life. And now suddenly Shukracharya is missing. Yeah. So the demons, they really started asking Shukracharya questions. Why did you do this to us? And the interesting thing is, in this particular episode, Shukracharya allows his disciples to ask him questions also. So, in life, sometimes questions have to be asked. And some of these questions are tough questions. The spiritual master here, in this particular case, is allowing his disciples to ask him tough questions. Shukracharya could have easily said, just shut your mouth. Why are you asking me such questions? You know, I am your guru, I can do what I want. But in this particular case, Shukracharya allows them to ask questions. Because only when you get clarity for your doubts, you can grow. So Shukracharya tells his disciples that I have purposely gone to the side of the demigods for a reason. And he explains that he is planning to perform a particular type of tapasya, which is very, very intense and very long tapasya. And he feels that at this point, when he goes away from the life of the demons for doing tapasya, if the demigods attack the demons, then they will be left nowhere. Because he is the one who protects them all the time. So Shukracharya felt, if I stay on the side of the demigods for some time, they will feel that I am their party, and they will feel that the demons have become very weak. And eventually, the demigods, when he goes for tapasya, the demigods will not even bother about attacking the demons. They will just say, they are weak people now, no point. That was his plan. And he said, I am going to acquire a power that will make you all practically immortal. So when they were given this explanation, the demons became really excited. They told their guru, please, please go ahead. We are there with you. We will do whatever you say. Shukracharya tells the demons, during the duration that I am not there, go and stay with my father, Bhrigu. And, you know, Bhrigu and Khyati, they're such powerful sages. He said, you will be safe over there. So then the demons all went and stayed with Bhrigu Muni in his ashram. And Shukracharya went for his tapasya. Now when Shukracharya went for his tapasya and the demons were with Bhrigu, the demigods attacked. Of course, Shukracharya also had told the demons, go to the demigods, keeping Prahlad in the front, and tell the demigods that we have become nice people now. You know, tell them that we have changed and we have become nice people and we are not going to do anything wrong. So the demons along with Prahlad Maharaj, they went to meet Indra and they explained, you know, that they have become nice people. So Brihaspati and Indra gave them a big lecture on how to be nice and why it is important to be nice. The demons are least bothered. They were not interested in the lecture at all. They just somehow tolerated and went away. Now they thought they are safe in Bhrigu Muni's ashram. And while they thought they were safe, just when they least expected it, the demigods attacked. Bhrigu Muni was also not there at that point. And the demons were being slaughtered like anything, right in the ashram of Bhrigu Muni. And while this was happening, Khyati, who was the wife of Bhrigu, she was very powerful personality also. So she came to the rescue of the demons and she froze Indra. She created a particular mantra and completely froze Indra. And now she was actually going to kill Indra. Can you imagine, you know, if the king of the heavens is dead? At that point, Lord Vishnu intervened. And Lord Vishnu sent a Sudarshan Chakra and cut off the head of Khyati. Now, this is one of the instances where Lord Vishnu kills a woman, basically. And apparently, when Khyati's head rolled off, suddenly Bhrigu Muni came over there. And he started chastising Vishnu like anything. He said, how dare you kill my wife? And he got so upset and so angry with Vishnu for killing his wife, that he cursed Vishnu, that because you separated me from my wife, I curse you that you have to take 7 births in the on the earth planet, and in one of the births you will be separated from your wife. And that's what, you know, comes in place during Ram's separation from Mother Sita, during the banishment, basically. Now when Vishnu was cursed like this, interestingly, he smiled. Now this is one of the characteristic features of Vishnu. The characteristic features of Vishnu is that in the middle of a calamity, he can smile. For most people in life, when they come across calamities, when they face calamities in life, they break. But the great devotees of the Lord and the Lord, the speciality is that in front of a calamity, they smile. Vasudev, when Kamsa was going to chop off the head of his wife Devaki, he was on the chariot, sword in one hand and Devaki's head in the other hand. And when he was just going to chop off the head of Devaki, Vasudev was standing over here, and what is he doing? He's smiling, you know. So apparently when you study these sections of the Bhagavatam, you might think that, what's wrong with these people? How can they smile in the midst of such a big danger? That's the smile which talks about inner stability. There was once a man who went to a saint, and he told the saint that, I have so many problems in my life. I have this problem, I have that problem, my health is bad, my job is bad, my family is in a bad shape. Hundreds of problems he had. So he said, can you help me solve my problems? The saint told him, I will definitely help you, but can you do me one help for tonight? Tomorrow morning I'll solve your problem. This man said, of course, you tell me what you want me to do. The saint said, I have 100 camels with me, and I want you to do just one small thing for me. Just before you go to sleep, you make these 100 camels sit down and then you go to sleep. Once they all sit, you go to sleep. This man said, yeah, very simple, I'll do that. And the saint went to sleep. This guy went to the camels and he tried to make all the 100 camels sit. And this guy had a time of his life, because every time one camel would sit, the other would stand up, you know. And he would make that camel sit, something else would stand up. All night long, he was just trying to make all the camels sit, you know. The next day morning, the saint met this man and he said, so did you sleep well? This man said, come on, all night I'm trying to make all your camels sit. Not, you know, at no given point of time, all camels were sitting, you know. One was sitting, then one would stand up. And then the other one would not sit only, you know. And then you somehow push it and make it sit, then somebody else will stand up, you know. So the saint said, this is exactly how our life is, how problems in our life are. The problems are like camels. Sometimes the problems are sitting and sometimes the problems are standing. And when one problem sits, rest assured another problem will stand up somewhere, you know. And when you try to solve that problem, the first problem will automatically sit, you know. So the saint said, just don't try to make all the camels sit. Just give it up. Just give up the idea that you can solve all your problems. And that's the idea in which many of these great personalities, when they come across problems in their life, they know that not all problems have solutions. Most problems have to be tolerated. A lot of problems have to be just neglected. Very few problems actually have tangible solutions in life. With time, certain problems just get solved on their own. We don't endeavor too much to try to solve them. While the demons were in such trouble, their guru, Shukracharya, was doing intense tapasya. And he was doing a particular type of tapasya which was unheard of. He was staying with the yakshas, and the yakshas had managed to arrange for a smoke chamber. So this was a small closed room which was filled with smoke. And in that smoke chamber, Shukracharya was standing on his head, upside down, for years, standing on his head, inhaling that smoke and no eating, no drinking at all, for years together. He did that kind of intense tapasya to please Lord Shiva. Finally, when Lord Shiva appeared in front of him, Shukracharya opened his eyes and Lord Shiva asked him, what boon do you want? And Shukracharya asked him for certain mantras and powers. And Lord Shiva blessed him. And when Lord Shiva left from there, Shukracharya was now rejuvenated. He got back. He realized there is somebody in that room. That's when he saw there was a beautiful girl in that room. And then Shukracharya realized this girl had been in that room all these years. And she had been assisting him in his tapasya. She had been silently just there, making sure that he is comfortable, making sure that, you know, his body is maintained, massaging his body at a certain point. So he's really taking care of him selflessly. Shukracharya realized he was actually grateful to that girl. And he asked her, what do you want? This girl, her name was Jayanti. And interestingly, she was a daughter of Indra. The girl obviously didn't tell Shukracharya this. She just told him that I want to get married to you. Shukracharya obviously was grateful, so he married her and he stayed with her for a few years. And this was a trick of the demigods to keep Shukracharya away from the demons. So while Shukracharya was away with Jayanti for many years, Brihaspati, who was the guru of the demigods, disguised himself as Shukracharya and went to the demons. And the demons saw Shukracharya suddenly come back. They were very surprised and they welcomed Shukracharya in. And Shukracharya, he said, I want to take classes for you. The demons were shocked because never in their life they ever attended any classes, you know. And here Shukracharya suddenly saying, I want to take classes, you know. And the demons had, maybe they thought that he has learned something new and come and he's, you know, planning to take classes. So Brihaspati was in Shukracharya's form. He started conducting intense classes on, you know, mode of goodness and how important it is to perform austerities and how it is to important to overcome good, overcome evil. They never heard of these concepts in their life, you know, and the demons were hearing, attending classes all day long. And slowly, the demons, they started changing, you know, their inner consciousness, inner nature started changing. One day, while these demons were in this, you know, state of hearing all these intense classes and all, suddenly one day, Shukracharya walked in, second Shukracharya, you know, and he said, kick that fellow out, he's an imposter. Now the demons are bewildered. They saw this one Shukracharya sitting over here, so many years they have been hearing from him, and suddenly a new Shukracharya comes in. They were completely confused. And the Shukracharya was sitting on that Vyasasana, he says, you have been hearing me for so many years, did you find that I was somebody else? I'm your well-wisher. And the new Shukracharya who came, he said, this fellow is a cheater. I am the real Shukracharya. I've been doing tapasya for you all. The demons had to make a quick decision at this point. Who is the real one? You know. Unfortunately for them, they concluded the person who is sitting on the Vyasasana is the real Shukracharya. And he told the original Shukracharya, get lost from here. We don't want you. You know. Shukracharya got so angry at the demons for choosing the wrong person. He cursed them. You know. That I curse you all that you all left me, so you will be condemned, you know. And he left. And suddenly they turned around, hoping that they made the right decision. And on the Vyasasana was sitting Brihaspati, smiling at them, you know. And then they realized they had totally messed up their life. So then, the demons, they ran to their guru. And they started begging him and pleading with him, somehow, please come back. They're really, you know, sorry for what they did. Shukracharya understood that, you know, it was his mistake only because he had not taught them to discriminate right from wrong. So Shukracharya, he agreed to come back on the condition that the demons will behave well with him and they'll take care of him. Now, when Shukracharya had come back, he had come back with some really intense powers. This was a particular mantra which he had acquired from Lord Shiva, which is known as a Mrita Sanjeevani mantra. By the power of the Mrita Sanjeevani mantra, he could revive a dead person. So then, once Shukracharya came back, the demons attacked the demigods again. And intense fights, every day attacks were going on. Every day quarrel and every day fights were going on. And the demigods started observing some interesting things. And they had a discussion. They said, Indra said, I killed one fellow yesterday and he was back today in fighting, you know. And somebody said, Are, I also had the same experience. I killed one fellow 3 times. He still came back, you know. So they had these weird experiences, how people who were dead before, they were alive the next day. That's when they realized Shukracharya got the Mrita Sanjeevani mantra. Then the demigods did something very interesting. The demigods sent one boy to Shukracharya's ashram. Now, this boy, his name was Kaccha. And interestingly, he was a disciple, he was a son of Brihaspati. Now imagine, the son of Brihaspati, who had done so much of, you know, mess to the demons, he came directly to Shukracharya's ashram and he's telling Shukracharya, I want to be your disciple. Now all the demons told Shukracharya, don't take him, he is dangerous, don't take him, he's a spy. But Shukracharya had some traits of, you know, being an acharya. So he said, no, no, no. And I looked at this boy. This boy seems really good. I want to take him as my student. So Shukracharya took this boy as his student. Now, when this boy became the student of Shukracharya, at that point, Shukracharya, he really started liking Kaccha. They kind of really connected very intensely, and he became one of his best disciples, doing so much for Shukracharya beyond what any other disciple would do. So Shukracharya really treated him as his favorite disciple. And all the demons, they were so envious of this boy, come from the demigod family, and he straight got into the guru's ashram, and he's become favorite disciple of the guru, you know. They kept a watch on him. They knew that this fellow is some trouble. They kept a watch on him. One day, this boy, he went to the forest to graze the cows. And while he was in the forest grazing the cows, the demons, they followed him. And they saw this guy sending some message through the pigeon. Immediately they understood he's a spy. They jumped on him, chopped him to pieces and killed him. Finished. Kaccha was dead. They threw the pieces here and there in the forest and they went away. By evening, Kaccha didn't come back home. And now Shukracharya was worried. He kept asking, where is Kaccha? Where is nobody saying anything? And the most shocking thing for Shukracharya was his daughter Devyayani, she was crying the most. That's when Shukracharya realized Devyayani had really got attached to Kaccha. She really loved Kaccha a lot. Now Shukracharya had no idea about this, you know, connection between Devyayani and Kaccha. Devyayani started saying, I can't live without Kaccha. I want him, you know. Then in the night they went to search for Kaccha in the forest. And they found Kaccha was missing, but his body pieces were here and there, you know. And Devyayani started crying like anything. So Shukracharya, he chanted the Mrita Sanjeevani mantra, and all the body pieces of Kaccha all assembled together, and suddenly Kaccha was alive again, you know, like a magical thing. Devyayani was so happy, she went and embraced Kaccha, and they were together again. Now, Shukracharya kept asking Kaccha, what happened? Who did this to you? And Kaccha had no idea who did this to him, because, you know, they attacked him from behind and they killed him before he even understood what happened, basically. He said, I have no idea. So he let go, and then, then they continued. Few days later, Kaccha again ventured out in the forest alone. And this time, the demons again caught him. They butchered him, cut him to pieces. This time, they didn't just throw the pieces here and there. They kept all the pieces together and burnt it. Completely burnt it to ashes. They took the ashes with them to the ashram. And they, from the ashes, they made a drink, a health drink, you know. And they went and offered it to a guru, Shukracharya. And can you imagine what kind of crazy people these are? So Shukracharya drank it, thinking that his disciples have given him a health drink, you know. And after drinking it completely, you know, and then later in the evening, Shukracharya, of course, now you don't ask me how he drank it and all that, I have no idea, but he drank it, you know. So after, Shukracharya drank it and all, later on he came to know Kaccha is missing again. So again, Devyayani started crying over here. So, you know, they went to the forest again for a search, and they found Kaccha is missing. There's no body parts anywhere. The demons did a clean job, you know, completely burnt him. And then Devyayani started crying intensely, saying, I can't live without him, I can't live without him. Now Shukracharya was in big anxiety. He was in big trouble. So he didn't know what to do. So at that point, Shukracharya decided to use his yogic powers and to find out where Kaccha is. He closed his eyes, intensely meditated, and then he realized Kaccha is inside him, you know. And then he told his daughter, I can't do anything, Kaccha is inside my body. I don't know how these guys made him inside my body, you know. And then he understood that these guys, his disciples, fed him a drink in which Kaccha's ashes were mixed. Devyayani said, nothing doing, I want Kaccha. So he said, Shukracharya said, if I get kaccha out, I will die. She said, no, I want you also, you know. So he said, how can both of us be alive? You know, if I get kaccha out, I will be dead. And if kaccha is dead, I'll be alive. So Devani said, nothing to do, I want both. That's when Shukracharya understood that everyone in this world is interested in self-preservation. They're interested in themselves, basically. They're not interested in others at all. The demons, they were not interested in the welfare of their own guru. They gave him a drink with ashes mixed in it. You know, can you imagine what kind of disciples these are? One time, there was an elderly Brahmin couple and they lost their son. Young boy, and they were feeling very, very sad about it. They carried the body to the crematorium and they were just about to cremate the boy. Just when they were going to cremate the boy, there was a vulture over there. And this vulture started telling this old Brahmin couple, why are you giving up hope so soon? Don't you have faith in higher powers? Why don't you just pray to the Supreme Lord and surely your boy will be revived? And this vulture started telling him stories of so many children who were revived by the power of prayers. Now this Brahmin couple, they got really great faith, you know, vulture is speaking, you know, and they decided to offer prayers. Just as they began to offer prayers, a jackal came there. And the jackal started telling, this Brahmin couple, are you gone crazy? Have you ever seen anybody come back to life like that? This fellow is just speaking like that, you know, you just burn him, or just cremate him, you know, right now cremate him. Now the Brahmins were confused, you know. So then the jackal started quoting so many scriptures of how once a body is dead, it can never come back to life, and so many, he's quoting Bhagavad Gita, he's quoting so many scriptures. And the Brahmin couple were confused again. So they said, chalo, we'll cremate, you know. The vulture again started speaking. He said, no, you should never do that. Always have hope. And these vulture and jackal were constantly, one was telling them, you know, cremate now, one fellow was telling, don't cremate now. And the Brahmin couple was so confused, you know. And in this confusion, while this confusion is going on, Lord Shiva and Parvati were passing by. And they saw this whole thing. And Parvati decided, you know, to recommend Lord Shiva. And Shiva revived that fellow, that boy. And all of them walked away. That's when the Brahmin couple understood that neither the jackal was a well-wisher, nor the vulture was a well-wisher. The vulture was telling them to wait. Why? So that the sun sets. Because the idea that the vulture had was he wanted to wait for them to, the sun to set, so that after sunset he can devour the corpse. And the jackal wanted to eat immediately, so he was saying bury them now only, you know. So both the jackal and the vulture, neither of them were well wishers of the Brahmin couple. They were thinking of their own life only. They were thinking of their own welfare only. So here Shukracharya, he realized he's in big trouble. And now he had to do something that he had never ever thought he would do. So what Shukracharya did, he closed his eyes and he started communicating with Kaccha, who was within his body. He started telling Kaccha, my dear disciple, I have only one option left now. That is to revive you. And the only other option for me to be revived is, I have to teach you the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra. And only when I teach you the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra, when you come back to life, you can revive me. Saying that, he gave the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra to Kaccha. And then he chanted the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra for Kaccha to be revived. Suddenly, Shukracharya's body is blasted, you know, into pieces. All over the room, there was all the, you know, blood and gore of Shukracharya's body. And then suddenly from all that mix, Kaccha got assembled and Kaccha was alive, you know. And now Kaccha had an option. Now Kaccha, what was he sent for? He was sent to learn the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra. He was not really sent to, you know, help Shukracharya in any way. Now he had learned the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra and Shukracharya was dead, basically. So he had an option of just walking away from that place. But he realized that Shukracharya had trusted him. He had deposited a lot of trust in him to the extent that he actually sacrificed his life to revive him, basically. So Kaccha said, it's not right for me to just walk away like this. So he chanted the Mudra Sanjeevani Mantra and revived Shukracharya.
Shukracharya came back to life. And Shukracharya was so grateful to Kachcha, and he was so proud of Kachcha, that in spite of being from the God side, he actually lived up to the trust of Shukracharya. And his disciples over here, they were on his side. What did they do to him? They fed him ashes of somebody, you know. So he realized that this Kachcha is a better disciple than any of my disciples, basically. And at this point, it is very interesting that Devyani was so happy that Kachcha is alive again. She ran to embrace him. Kachcha said, "Wait, don't touch me." Devyani was confused. She said, "What happened?" He said, "Now we can't continue in this relationship." So at this point, Shukracharya was really impressed with Kachcha. You know why? Because from Kachcha's point of view, from this point onwards, his relationship with Shukracharya had changed, and naturally his relationship with Devyani had changed. Shukracharya at this point had become the father of Kachcha, because Kachcha came out from Shukracharya's body, you know. So in that sense, Devyani and Kachcha were brothers and sisters, basically. So he said, now relationship is over. So it was like a cultural context, you know. And Shukracharya was very impressed with Kachcha's thinking. Now, here we find that at different points in our life, we have to learn to let go of different things that we are attached to. The Mahabharata talks about three people who were so attached to three different things. The Mahabharata talks about Dhritarashtra, who was attached to his position. The Mahabharata talks about Bhishma, who was attached to his principles, his vows. He had taken a vow that I'll never marry. He had taken a vow that I will never sit on the throne of Hastinapur. I'll always protect the throne. And he was attached to it, so intensely attached to it. And the third was Dronacharya, who was attached to his son. So one was attached to position, one was attached to principles, and one was attached to his son. And these three people's attachments caused the whole Mahabharata war. If Dhritarashtra was not attached to that position of his, then so much of problems would have been solved. If Bhishma was not attached to the principles that he had, there was no question of war only, because he is the right person to sit on the throne. And if Drona was not attached to his son Ashwatthama, all the wrong that Ashwatthama did would not have happened. And because they just held on to their attachment, so many problems happened. The same Mahabharata talks about the next generation of devotees. The next generation, and the generation after that, and one generation after that. The younger people. So these are the older people who are attached to the three things. And the younger people, they were ready to give up their attachment. Yudhishthir was attached to speaking the truth. But when Krishna told him to speak a lie, he spoke. He gave up that attachment to a principle that he held on for life. Bhishma had an attachment to a principle, but he couldn't let go of that principle because he held on to it too hard. Yudhishthira was ready to let go the principle of speaking the truth for the higher purpose. And we find that in the Mahabharata, Parikshit Maharaj, when he was cursed to die in 7 days and seven nights, instantly he let go of his attachment to the position. The moment he got that curse, he walked out from the throne of Hastinapur. He just walked out from the position that he had. Dhritarashtra had such an intense attachment that even at the ripe old age, he was thinking of sitting on the throne. And here is a young boy, young man, Parikshit, peak of his youth, one moment ready to let go of his attachments. And then we find Janmajaya, the son of Parikshit. He was attached to his opinion of performing the snake sacrifice, for taking revenge of all the snakes, especially Takshak, who killed his father. And then the sages told him, let go. And immediately Janmajaya let go, because the sages told him. So now three older people, so attached to what they felt was right, and three younger people who were ready to let go and go ahead for a higher purpose. So here, when Shukracharya saw Kachcha so young, but so detached, ready to let go of a relationship which was so important for him, because from a higher cultural context, Shukracharya was very impressed. Now Kaccha, his mission was accomplished. It was time for him to return to the gods again, to the devatas. He had learned the Mutta Sanjeevani mantra. He had learned whatever he needed to learn from Shukracharya, and he was leaving. While Kaccha was leaving, he had a very powerful realization, a very important realization, which is kind of the essence of this whole story. The realization that Kaccha had was, now, I mean, imagine Kaccha's situation, you know. Kaccha was the son of the devatas, you know, Brihaspati's son. And here he was a student of Shukracharya. He is Brihaspati's son, Shukracharya's disciple. He had lived with the gods. He had stayed with them. I mean, he was born there. He knows them in and out. And now he has stayed with the demons also for a couple of years. So he knows them also in and out. He had seen the defects of the gods, and he had seen the defects of the demons. He saw the good of the gods, and he saw the good of the demons also. The interesting thing is now, for Kaccha, as an individual, look at this whole story in the context of this understanding that Kaccha had. The whole story talks about how two groups of people are fighting so intensely, which is what human society is. The human society is constantly a situation of quarrel. Here in this purport, we find this conflict inevitably gives rise to anger. Just one sentence before that. The desire for material association arises from one's propensity to deny that everything is God's energy. Falsely imagining material sense objects to be separate from the Supreme Lord, one desires to enjoy them. Such desire gives rise to conflict and quarrel in human society. This conflict inevitably gives rise to great anger, which makes human beings become foolish and destructive. Thus, the actual goal of human life is quickly forgotten. So Kaccha had seen the fights. He had seen how the gods and the demons were ready to do anything to kill each other, were ready to do anything to, you know, win over each other. What he realized is very important for all of us to understand. Kaccha's realizations was, the daityas, the rakshasas, the demons, they were evil. And the devatas, the demigods, they were good. Now, what is the difference between daityas and devatas? Daityas do what is papa. They do a lot of sin. The devatas do a lot of punya. They do a lot of pious activities. But what Kaccha realized is the daityas, when they do papa, when they do sin, what is the sin they do? They actually feel that I don't need to enjoy myself by working hard. I just have to snatch it from somebody else and enjoy myself. So papa means I snatch things from other people for my enjoyment. And what is punya? Punya means I earn merits. I do good activities and earn merits so that I can enjoy. What Kaccha realized is both the gods and the demons, their goal is enjoyment. The gods want to enjoy by piety. The demons want to enjoy by papa. The gods want to enjoy by earning it meritly. The demons want to enjoy by snatching it forcefully. He realized both the mindsets, there's no difference. Both want to enjoy only. Both were thinking of happiness. The gods were thinking of happiness. The demons were thinking of happiness. The gods were thinking of happiness by doing punya. The demons were thinking of getting happiness by doing papa. The gods were thinking of getting happiness by merit. The demons were thinking of getting happiness by snatching it. Kaccha realized he stayed with both of them. He stayed with the demons. He was born to the gods. He realized there's no difference in the mindset between both. Both are exactly same. And his conclusion was very interesting. His conclusion was the Mrita Sanjeevani mantra that he was actually looking for, the Mrita Sanjeevani mantra that he got from Shukracharya, that is not the Mrita Sanjeevani mantra that actually is valuable. Kaccha got another Mrita Sanjeevani mantra from this whole process of churning and realization. The Mrutasanjivani mantra that Kachcha got was, more important than happiness is satisfaction. Why? Because he realized the gods have so much, the demigods have so much, still they are not satisfied. They still want more and more and more. They keep acquiring more and more and more. The demons, they don't have much, but they're still not satisfied because they keep grabbing it from others. And how much ever they grab, they still want more. What Kachcha realized is, as long as you run behind happiness, you'll never be satisfied. You'll never be peaceful in life. Because when you run behind happiness, when you don't get it, you will fight for it. And if you get it, you will want more of it. What Kachcha realized is, the Mrutasanjivani mantra that I have to cultivate in my life is not the search for happiness. It is the search for satisfaction. And when I look for satisfaction, then I don't have to, with what I have, I can be satisfied. I don't have to grab it from somebody else. Or I don't have to keep fighting for acquiring more and more of it. Or I don't even have to protect what I have. Satisfaction is something within. It doesn't depend on any external circumstances. And therefore, here we find in this purport that thus the actual life, the goal of human life is quickly forgotten. Which essentially means, if we get into this whole mood of quarrel, if you get into the whole mood of fighting for happiness, your focus on the purpose of human life gets lost completely. And therefore, more important than trying to fight for happiness, you have to look for satisfaction. This is not just relevant to the demigods and the demons. It is as much relevant in the Brahmachari ashram. It is as much relevant in family life today. Because everyone is not satisfied with what they have. And they are all looking for happiness in what they don't have. I'll end with this very interesting story. I love this story. It's a very beautiful, but it's a story with a deep message. There was once a small boy who wanted to have a holiday from school. So he decided to play a prank on the school. So what he did was, after school hours, he came back. And he got with him 3 sheep. And he numbered the sheep. He put number 1 on the first sheep, he put number 2 on the second sheep, and he put number 4 on the third sheep, and he sent them inside the school. And the next day morning, when the staff and the cleaners came, they found sheep litter all over. They started running around the whole school searching for the sheep. They found 3 sheep, number 1, number 2, and number 4. They were wondering, where is the number 3 sheep that is missing? They searched all over the school, and they couldn't find the number 3 sheep that was missing. They declared a holiday, emergency. There's one sheep roaming around in the classes. What are they searching for? They were searching for the number 3 sheep that didn't exist. Similarly, just like these people, all of us are exactly like these people. We have the number 1, number 2, and number 4 sheep in our life. In so many aspects. But we are all thinking happiness lies in a number 3 sheep that is missing from our life. And in the pursuit of running behind the number 3 sheep that is missing in our life, we forget to be grateful and we forget to be satisfied with the 1, 2 and 4 that already exists. Every human being is running behind the number 3 sheep, which is illusory and doesn't exist at all. Whether in the Brahmachari ashram, whether in the Grihastha ashram, whether among devotees, whether among non-devotees, everyone is running behind the number 3 sheep that doesn't exist. And the number 3 sheep is different for different people, right? And the interesting thing is, in the process of running behind the number 3 sheep, we just forget to be grateful for the 1, 2 and 4 that already exists in our life. And that's what we learned from this whole story. And the message that Krishna is trying to share with us in this verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Very grateful for your patient hearing and attention. Hopefully some of what I spoke will help you all in your personal lives. And seeking blessings from all the devotees that I can apply what I spoke in my own life also. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki.